tonight. It's an important evening for us all, including my family. My mom wrote me today, sent me a text message, said, 50 years ago, it's our anniversary. Not when we were married, but 50 years ago, your father sent me a card. It was the first time he said, I love you. 50 years. Tonight, as we gather for this sacred evening, we're honest about our hearts, the state of our hearts, and the fragmented pieces of them. Those pieces of a heart that we have given away over the last year, as we chase promises that have left us empty, always striving for that next bit of approval or accomplishment. Tonight, you will hear the ancient invitation. Return to me with your whole heart. This return begins with acknowledging our fragmented selves, especially the parts we've given away and are in need of return. And of course, in this space and all of our festivals, there is good news. Yes, we are made of dust, you will hear. Yet it's the very dust into which God breathed life. The same divine breath of love awaits us whenever we return wholeheartedly. It's a love that brings us all back, a love that mends us, offering true wholeness that can't be found anywhere else except here. May this night then be for you, all those gathered in the heights and at home, a step now in our journey of 40 days, a bringing all of ourselves, even the imperfect, fragmented pieces, before the God who offers endless grace. Grace given to you now. Let us rise.
Faithful before, you'll be faithful. is a raging sea right in front of me, wants to pull me in, bring me to my knees. So let the waters rise if you want them to. I will follow you. I will follow you. I will follow you.
You may be seated. Almighty and ever-living God, you hate nothing you have made, and you forgive the sins of all who are penitent. Create in us new and honest hearts, whole hearts, so that truly repenting of our past, we may receive from you, the God of all mercy, full and complete pardon this evening. Forgiveness through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Thank you. Good evening. Ooh, that was loud. As we mark our foreheads with dust, we acknowledge our mortality, that we come from the earth, and to the earth we shall return. Yet this dust traces the life-giving cross indelibly marked on our foreheads at baptism. While we journey through Lent to return to God, let us remember that we have already been reconciled to God through Christ. We humbly pray for God to cleanse our hearts, rejoicing in the knowledge that now is the day of salvation. As we return to our baptismal call, we strive to bear the fruits of mercy and justice in the world more intentionally. Let us now reflect on the Word of God. Joel chapter 2, verses 1, 2, and 12 say, "Blow the trumpet in Zion, sound the alarm on my holy hill. Let all who live in the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. It is close at hand, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and blackness. Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning." This passage from Joel is a prophetic warning of an impending locust invasion, symbolizing God's judgment. It calls us to return to the Lord, our God, emphasizing the need for genuine repentance and wholehearted return to God. Psalm 51, verses 1 and 2 read, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out our transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin." This psalm, a prayer of repentance, was written by David after his affair with Bathsheba and his murder of Uriah, her husband. It is a plea of mercy, a confession of sin, and a request for renewal. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20 says, "Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God." In this passage, Paul describes how God has reconciled us through Christ and given us a ministry of reconciliation. We are called to be ambassadors for Christ, urging others to be reconciled to God. May these words guide us as we journey through this season of Lent, seeking reconciliation, practicing our faith, and striving to live out God's love and mercy in the world.
Before Jesus is about to be crucified, and he comes into Jerusalem looking to take steps towards the cross. As he's doing this, people catch word that Jesus is coming, their Savior, and the response to this is overwhelming. The people of Jerusalem have decided they're going to get palm branches. Palm branches are a symbol of victory, as Jesus is riding in, his people, his followers, those who believe him to be the Messiah, are looking to raise up to him to show him that they believe that he is there to redeem them, to take them out of the hands of tyranny. The belief of Ash Wednesday comes from an idea of sacrifice, an idea of change. So we take these symbols and we burn them. We take away what we thought was one thing, and Jesus turns it into another. So what we do is we take the branches from the Palm Sunday of the previous year, and we take them and we burn them, take the ashes. We combine them with something like an anointing oil or holy water to create a paste. And with this paste, we mark the foreheads of those of us who are coming to remember Lent. We're coming to remember that Christ made the ultimate sacrifice. And so for us, 40 days of being able to let go of something that we enjoy, something that we look at as a luxury, it's just a small sacrifice, a small reminder of the sacrifices and the things that Jesus did for us. Palm branches and ashes, they're just symbols, but they're symbols that help us remember. They remind us that Jesus' sacrifice was bigger, stronger, wider. And so for that, we choose to go throughout our day with an ash cross on our forehead.
The history of today can be traced all the way back to ancient Rome. 2,500 years ago, the 8th century before Christ, February 13th through the 15th, just not a day, just not February 14th. This is when the ancient Romans celebrated the feast of Lupercalia. Roman men, it said, sacrifice goats before using the goat skins to give to women, believing that this would make them more fertile. At the end of the 5th century, the Pope, Gelasius, declared February 14th to be Valentine's Day. He attempted to reclaim the festival from the Romans and Christianize it. He did this by canonizing Saint Valentine. We're not sure if it's Saint Terni or Saint Valentine of Rome, but it was about 500 years after Christ. And then in the 1400s, February 14th became this annual feast day in France. So you can thank the French for this one. Banquets with singing and dancing were held to celebrate romantic love. During this time, a Frenchman imprisoned in the Tower of London wrote the earliest surviving Valentine's greeting to his wife, much like my father's 50 years ago. He's imprisoned because he is the resistance against the English, and they bring him back to the Tower of London, and they allow him to write his wife. And in this greeting is this. I am already sick with love, my very gentle Valentine. Shakespeare mentions Valentine's Day in Hamlet. Today, it is the day of Saint Valentine. In the play, you hear from Shakespeare, all in the morning betime, and I a maid at your window to be your Valentine. And the most famous poem of this day, recited by my kids this morning, it's in a collection of nursery rhymes, and it goes like this. The rose is red, the violets blue, the honey sweet, and so are you. There you have it. And these, the first Valentine's cards. Initially, they were handmade cards. And I actually still have to make mine yet before I arrive home this evening. Did you receive a handmade card? Did you? Remember when you were kids? Now, my kids, they'll just get candy. And then they'll give it to their friends in their classroom. They had to make these really fancy boxes. Mrs. Anderson remembers this. And I said, well, where are the cards? Aren't you going to write the cards out and write all your friends? Oh, no. They're just going to hand out the candy. I'm like, this sounds an awfully lot like Halloween, or we're getting confused here. Where are the cards? But that's how it started. In the 18th century, it was handmade cards, and lovers would decorate paper with romantic symbols like flowers and love knots. It often included puzzles and more lines of poetry. These cards were then slipped secretly then under the door of your love or tied to the door knocker on the door. At any rate, this day, tonight, it's a matter of the heart. We often think of these next 40 days of Lent as fixing our external behaviors, which are all pretty good ones. The church always comes up ones with kids, and I'm working with them right now. Give up a favorite toy or a game. Fast from social media, and really they should be, even if they're young. And then in the teens and beyond, then we're working with our families that way. We know firsthand research shows it's terrible for them. So at least we can start with these 40 days if they're into it. Give up a favorite snack. Drink only water at school. Give up a favorite chair at home or a seat at school for somebody that needs to take a seat. Go without headphones or AirPods for a day. Play your favorite game, focusing on helping others instead of winning. That's a big one. Allow others to pass in front of you in the lunch line. And then we have some general ideas. Perhaps give up coffee. I've tried to do that, but I just can't. Maybe you're able to do it. Or only brew it at home and give up Starbucks. Give up alcohol. We're finding that is very important, and some of you have known this for quite some time, how alcohol is detriment to your health, and certainly 40 days, perhaps, you can give that up. Certain social media, not only for kids, but for the whole family as well. Give up electronics after a certain time in the day. One thing that I saw in the church lately is give up a pillow and just sleep on the bed. I won't be doing that one, but wake up without hitting the snooze button. Maybe keep your curtains open. Shower without it being hot. We're seeing the benefits of that, too. That could really wake you up and get your body moving for the day. Keep the thermostat several degrees cooler. Again, this is something that we would struggle with at our house. We keep it at 70, and people walk in our home and they think it's like a sauna. But maybe you want to look at that. Parking in the back parking lot and say a prayer as you walk into the grocery store or anywhere for that matter. Abstain from reading gossip or rumor sites or scrolling. Surrendering then more and more of your time so that you can focus on those misplaced parts of your hearts. The truth is, I don't think my problem is too much sugar. These are all the rage now. These big malts and shakes that are just covered. I'm all about this. But I don't know if Bridgman's has this, but this looks good to me. But I don't know if I really have too much of an issue with sugar or scrolling on Instagram. My problem, and maybe yours too, is that I have parceled out pieces of my heart to things that can't love me back. My starving little heart seeks fulfillment in loves that can't love me back. Empty promises. Perhaps for you, maybe it's the approval of a difficult boss, a few more likes on a post, or just one more level conquered in a video game. I made a mistake and I introduced this to my kids. And I'm always saying, look, you need to help out with chores. And their response consistently is, I need to pass just one more level and then I can help you. And then I take that little device and I chuck it across the room. Super Mario Brothers Deluxe. My girls love this one. Just one more level achievement, Dad, and then we can help. I'm reading now that children who try their hand at playing multiple instruments have a higher chance of becoming elite musicians like we have in our balcony this evening. Even if they specialize later in life, more so than those who have been presented with a particular one instrument from a very early age. And as I listen to them this evening, as we do gathered here at church and those at home, they are remarkable. But my problem is, unlike our musicians this evening, I played most of the instruments across my lifetime, and I can't play one of them very well. And I kind of take that, my heart kind of, I look at how wonderful they are up there and how great they are at leading worship and how nice that would be. So I have a guitar. I've tried trumpet with Aaron. I'm learning piano with Sylvie. She's 10 years old and she's much better at it already than I am. See, it's something that I take very seriously and love. But it hasn't loved me back. It has loved perhaps others, but not your pastor. And I typically will do anything, relying on anything and everything but God to meet my deepest needs. We even love each other poorly, only with scraps of our hearts left over after we've poured ourselves into our careers, ambitions, saving the world, or the numbing escape of the internet, binges, and addictions. There is a reason why our parking lot is full on Thursdays. It's not so much our time we waste on these things. It's something infinitely more precious, our whole hearts. So here we are on Ash Wednesday, in unity with the whole church, and we bring all of our fragmented pieces of ourselves, this broken, you deserve a break today, mess of our hungry hearts, and hear the solemn words. Remember, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. It's the exact thing that we're desperate to ignore and run away from. We give our hearts away because deep down we're facing our limitations, the reality of our collective last breath. In so many ways, large and small, we sin out of our deep-seated fear of aging and death. You'd think, hearing you are dust would be terrible news. But when you hear it, oh no, 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 no. Au contraire. Because in Genesis, we meet our Lord God, our God who formed us from the very dust of the ground, then breathed into us the breath of life. Yes, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. But never forget, it's from this dust and God's divine breath that you were born. Created out of pure, eternal love and nothing else. And this same love patiently mends this evening your whole heart each time you return. Now, for just a moment, as you approach for ash and the dust and communion, consider, where have you given a fragment of your heart in your life, and especially lately? What pursuit, worry, or distraction feels like it owns a piece of you? It's time for God to take it back. Offer it to God in prayer, even if it feels maybe a little clumsy this evening. That in itself is the very start of your return.
Lord, may I be an instrument of thy peace.
Hello, my love. Salut de l'amour by Edward Elgar. Thank you, Amy and Julie. Let us rise. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
In the night in which he handed himself over, in the greatest act of love, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. For those of you at home, you are welcome to participate in the imposition of ashes as well. Place a cross on yours and beloved's forehead with the words, "Remember you are dust, and to dust you shall return." And for those who cannot be with us this evening, we've met a number of them here at the office during our office hours, and we also have ashes to go. Come, God's beloved.
sing to thee. How sweet the sound, how sweet the key. We're lost and found in his amazing love. For by his grace you have been saved, his love and faith, his mercy reigns, his gifts to you we're singing.
Embracing this great gift of the church and truth in Christ is unbelievably freeing. And I preach it, I proclaim it, but I learn it from you. As I watch you, life happens, and you calmly carry on. Embracing this truth, we are dust, and to dust we shall return. It is what it is, never forgetting what God does with the is. Let us rise. Beloved, we are God's own people, holy, washed, renewed. God bless you and keep you, shower you with mercy, fill you with courage, and give you peace. Amen.
Thank you.
in peace. Share your ash. Share your bread. Thanks be to God.